All right, welcome everyone to the Archon Team League Championships. We're on to the last week of phase one, or week seven, day two. We've already had a pretty exciting day yesterday. In fact, both of you casting with me today have played in that day. One of you, obviously, with better results. When you face off against each other, both can't win. So, Gaara, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great. I hope to pick up as much as possible from the Grand Master Champion, Kibler. And I'm very excited to custom games.
Yeah, Kibler, are you still on the high from yesterday's big big win, getting the Master of Duels title?
Well, Twitch, I would say that I'm always high, but no, I mean, I'm definitely feeling great. You know, it was a big win yesterday. It was a lot of fun to be able to, you know, sort of pull that out with the team, and I'm so excited to see who might be joining us in Texas today.
Yeah, so today we'll have, again, two matches. It's going to be Team Archon versus Team Celestial. Celestial already confirmed as being eliminated. One of the two teams that's currently, you know, guaranteed to keep the spot that they've acquired. And Cloud9 is also first over Value Town based on the standings. So the tiebreaker matters. So you might see here the game wins on the side being a little lower for Cloud9, but in fact, their tiebreaker means their entire game wins minus losses is a bit better. So as a result, it turns out that they've got one tiebreaker point over Value Town. So they're both going to be in the grand finals with Cloud9 with the advantage of picking the brackets and how they're going to look. And as a second match of the day, we're going to have Team Liquid versus Forsen Boys. There can be a little bit of shuffling around, and I think at this point, it matters a lot more for Team Liquid and Forsen Boys trying to get out of that 6th and 7th spot to make sure they're out of the redemption phase.
I think that I have to root today for Liquid and Celestial, because that would kind of guarantee us third place.
Right, of course.
Because we lost to Forsen Boys and Archon, so if they would win...
Yeah, there's a lot of hate wins, I guess, right now. Like, you could have a lot of people, you know, I guess, push other teams from somewhere near the top to much lower on the bottom, I think, based on the results that we're going to have today. So the games today, although you might feel like they don't matter as much because first and second place are out, the teams that are involved are really, they really want to get those wins, if only to push other ones down with them. You know, when you're in the dumpster, drag everybody along.
I also hope that Celestial gets at least one win. I mean, they're all very great players, and it looks really bad to finish the league without getting like one serious win.
Yeah.
I was going to say the same thing. I really hope that Team Celestial, you know, managed to put up a win today. You know, I've been really impressed, you know, particularly with Tiddler and Silent Storm. Frozen Eyes has definitely struggled a bit in the league, at least. And he was the least well-known player going into this. So it's hard to say, you know, what exactly is going on there. But despite this being the Archon Team League, I have to root against Team Archon in this match because I want to see Celestial get on the board.
Yeah, I could see that. I mean, everybody wants to see them get a point. Crip says it doesn't matter because, you know, at this point, they're already way at the bottom. You might as well not even try. But hopefully we get to see a little bit of a reversal there. Maybe even a nice win and a convincing one against Archon. I think that'd be the craziest thing. Like a complete sweep at the very end there when they're already gone. Just making a stand before they exit the stage. Now, before we move on to the first game, Archon versus Celestial, of course, we're just a quick shout out to all the partners we've got. AlphaDraft.com. If you guys want to check them out, get involved into Esports Fantasy League. They're giving away like $300,000 each week. So you can check them out and maybe get a sign up deposit of $250. So check those out. And Amazon App Store, of course, you can check the promotion on teamarcon.com/Amazon or on amazon.com/Hearthstone for the 50% off of 40 packs for classic card packs. All right. Now that that's out of the way, we should be getting under the, you know, getting the list of the classes for the both teams. I don't expect anything completely out of the ordinary, but Celestial having nothing to lose, do you think they'll bring something completely out of our expectations?
Oh, it looks like they're going with a pretty standard lineup. They do have both Druid and Paladin, which is a little bit unusual. Well, I'm trying to figure. They also, this is very strange.
Yeah,
I was gonna say this is the second team in a row. You know, we saw I believe Nihilim did not bring Hunter yesterday, which was mind blowing to me because Hunter I think is, you know, the best performing class stat wise in the league. But here it looks like Team Celestial is going with exactly the same thing.
It's like the first time Silent Storm brings Rogue. He brought like all sorts of classes. He brought Shaman ones, Druid, and this. I think also the first time they bring Rogue as a class, Team Celestial.
It might be
something new.
No, Frozen Eyes did try Rogue, I think, on week two or three, but he just lost two games with it, and I think it just didn't pan out, so they never brought it again. So, yeah, that was a failed experiment on that week, but I'm actually surprised because you'd expect maybe one of the players to feel comfortable enough with it that they'd bring it, since it's such, you know, initially in the league it was a pretty strong class, but they've been staying away from it for quite a while.
Yeah, well, the one class here that I'm kind of surprised to see both classes or both teams bringing is Druid. Druid is a class that has really struggled so far in Archon Team League. It was responsible for you know two of my losses the week that I played Druid and could not you know draw Wild Growth for the life of me. So in particular with how popular Mech Shaman has gotten, which is a very very difficult deck for Druid to beat. It doesn't really seem to have that many great matchups and has largely struggled in the league so far.
Well, that's at worst a 50% win rate in a
50-50. Yeah, here we have the best matchup for Druid, the mirror match.
Yeah, you can't go wrong with that. Gara, what are your thoughts on Druid? Because a lot of people have been saying that the deck itself is fine, but somehow its performance is underwhelming. What do you think is the reason behind that?
Well, stat-wise, first of all, Druid is much better than what people think it is. It is like, in tournaments, between 55% and 58% win ratio, which is the second best class slash deck in the game. First is Hybrid Hunter. Like Monk has like all stats, and this is like a really large sample size of like 400 games or something.
This is really interesting seeing right here. It's very different from normal Druid. I'm interested to see what Tiddler's actually doing right here. He's got a Leprenomen and a Loot Hoarder in his hand.
Yeah, they think that's Token Druid perhaps, right?
Yeah. But it's like even in Token Druid, you usually don't run Leprenomen and Loot Hoarder.
Is this the post-TGT Druid draft? He's like, he's trying to get the skeleton of the deck and then he's just going to push it once the Grand Tournament comes out. And he's like, if I can win with this Druid deck, then I've made my stand on Archon Team League after I'm done.
I think the coolest thing about Druid is even if you face a counter, you can still win if you get the right draws. If you get like Innovated Wildgrowth, even in your worst matchups, you still can win. And there's only very few decks. Like, Druid has like no auto-loss matchup.
You're right, that's a great point. Yeah, I think that's a great point. And it speaks to the versatility of the class that's enabled by the ramp, right? As you said, like, getting those Savage Roars with Force of Nature gives you a lot of easy losses, easy wins, and then you can avoid bad starts just by getting the Innervate Wild Growth, which is pretty broken in many cases.
I mean, Druid definitely has some of the best really good draws of any class, but its bad draws are also so bad. You know, so many of the high power cards that it's planning to ramp into with, you know, Innervate and Wild Growth. If you draw those and you don't draw Innervate and Wild Growth, you literally just don't do anything. I mean, that was, like I was saying, you know, my experience playing Druid a couple of weeks ago, I pressed my hero power and pointed at my opponent for the first several turns, and that is just not a winning strategy.
So do you think it's just going to go full face here? I mean, is there even a reason to slow down when you've got such a good board and your opponent's starting to play on the defensive? Where shall
I strike? I'm kind of curious. I was curious to see if he would go cat is for fight there and just go straight face. But I'm actually a little surprised that Firebat chose not to bear up last turn. You know, he just played the piloted Shredder rather than playing a Druid of the Claw in bear form when he was, you know, pretty clearly facing quite a bit of damage.
What about perhaps he was afraid of Wrath hero power with the Loot Hoarder trading into it and then the Shredder keeps attacking him anyway?
Yeah, but I mean, what's his plan after that point? You know, if he did try to, you know, play around it that way, it looks like here he's going to get off a reasonable swipe.
This is the most Loot Hoarders you will ever see in a Druid mirror.
Yeah, seriously.
Just you wait for the Grand Tournament. Everybody's going to be playing, of course, two of them. Okay, this is definitely Token, and what a sick cure for Tiddler.
This is kind of interesting. I mean, so Firebat is at 15. If he wants, he can potentially play, like, you know, Leprenome, Harvest Golem, Power of the Wild, attack you for 5, have a pretty big board, but that doesn't really change all that much. Yeah, I think he's just going to go with the, maybe even just the minion from Power, or just attack in the face.
Interesting to note is that Force of Nature, Power of the Wild is a turn 8 combo. I mean, sure, you're losing quite a bit of damage, but you're going from 6 to 9 with just those two cards, so you can get a bit more reach through that. It's kind of interesting to see that it might come into play here.
That Ancient of War might be just a little bit too slow here. If Firebat can... Oh, no, actually, Firebat has the Druid plus hero power and attack into one of the guys, so he's not quite... Ooh, and that Vitality Totem is actually pretty big. The zero power minion there means that even with Savage Roar, Tiddler, you know, doesn't really have a big damage threat from that.
Oh my goodness. Tiddler, I'm in love. I'm loving this. All right, so let's see if there's like a Gore Hell, right?
Yeah, if he gets Gore Hell, he just wins.
No. And it's a two power weapon, and what did... Oh, against a...
Also free power.
Rax.
No, it's a 3-2 vanilla. What's that card already that has those stats? It's not the bow.
Fiery War Axe.
Yeah, it's got to be the Fiery War Axe, pretty much.
All right, well, and this actually lets Firebat play... Ooh, there's an Ancient, and then there's going to be another one next turn. So now, Tiddler actually needs to find, I think, a Keeper to actually get through this. Although, actually, yeah. Does he actually have enough just with Force of Nature? With Force of Nature, he has 6, 10... No, he's actually...
He's a little shy.
Damage off with just Force of Nature.
Still has both right. Keepers.
Does he even run chance. Keepers?
That would be something. How can you not run Keeper?
Can you imagine that? Just the Tiddler deck. So Blinktron Druid is real. I bet you he plays Savagery because he's got nothing to lose. You play Blinktron Savagery just because you can.
I didn't even know that worked.
It's amazing. You have to do it once.
I think Firebat's debating whether he wants to potentially expose himself to swipe Keeper by attacking into the damaged golem and putting himself to 6.
Yeah, but Keeper would kill you anyway, right?
That's true, yeah. I imagine he was probably just thinking through, okay, what are the things that you know are problematic for me here? Ooh,
that's pretty sick.
That's pretty much a good game on the following turn, right?
Well, no, because there's another Druid. Oh, but that's actually, yeah, their Ancient is not going to be enough, because Hero Power put him to 3 here. Yeah. He actually is going to be able to kill him.
And the weapon is going to be important for this.
The Force Roar is going to be able to go through the Ancient of War. Wild Growth, that's not going to do it. Despite having Ancient of War on turn 7 and turn 8, it looks like Tiddler is going to be able to push through with his Leper Gnome Druid deck.
So Tiddler is going to be the former...
Arch Commander, what's even happened?
What the hell is going on? Gaara, did you playtest anything like... Because you're the kind of player who builds like the most funky deck I've ever seen.
How do you... I think people underestimate how big of an advantage you have when your opponent doesn't know your deck list. It's like if the deck has to be decent though. It doesn't work out if the deck just sucks. But if it's good, like if you test it enough, it's such a big advantage because when you play against Patron or all those standard decks, people know. Right. Basically 28 or 29 cards of the deck list at least, and then you play around everything. But if you don't know what to expect, I really like that type of playstyle in tournaments.
Yeah.
Too bad we won't see his deck.
There's definitely a lot of value to being able to, you know, sort of surprise your opponents. I mean, something like Blingtronic especially is, you know, both weapon removal and, you know, just total out of nowhere additional source of damage that, I mean, in that match actually was very, very valuable. You know, it gave Tiddler, you know, enough resources to actually just continue punching through those taunts.
It's also pretty lucky to get the Druid Mirror, I feel like. Like, if I would bring Druid in this league, it's like one of the best matchups to get the Druid Mirror.
Yeah, I guess it kind of is, but at the same time, like against a warrior, would it be worth it to override their Death's Bite with a Blinktron? So maybe he was trying to do something funky. The thing is, they've got nothing to lose, right? Team Celestial is in a position where they're either here to have fun or get a point on the table. And if you bring a Blinktron Druid to a tournament, it's either experimental or you're just trying to, you know, give people a good show. And if I want to be honest, this was probably the coolest Druid deck we've seen in this entire league so far.
Oh, definitely.
That's just Druid deck in general.
Right, I guess. It doesn't get much better than this. Now, we need to get the deck list to know if there were Savageries and Bites, because that would also just be, you know, an extra bit of phase damage. But it looked like a token Druid implementing Blinktron as an extra tool to remove maybe taunts that get in the way. I like the concept of it. All right. So, do you have any expectations as to what Team Celestial is going to do here? Now that the... I assume it's Patron Warrior standard that Tiddler brought.
He just played Blingtron Druid, saying that, you know, he probably is playing standard Patron Warrior. May not be giving him enough credit. I wouldn't be... I actually, you know, seeing that deck makes me think... maybe.
Goldshire Footman and Oyotron bolster Hobgoblin Dream?
I do not believe in the Goldshire Footman Dream. The bolster dream, the Hobgoblin Dream, these I can see, but...
Okay. So apparently you just don't believe he's ready enough for action, I guess.
I do not, no. I think that he should go to a tournament, you know, be a tournament attendee, and then maybe he can
be
a little bit better.
Yeah. So, looks like... So far, Frozen Ice's deck doesn't look like anything out of the ordinary. So far. We haven't seen it all. Maybe there are interesting cards we've never seen, like Sacrificial Pact.
I don't know how many games you casted from Team Celestial, but Frozen Ice was so unlucky in almost every Zoo game he played in the entire tournament. He always had like double Doomguard, double Implosion, stuff like that. In almost every game he played with Zoo. It's like...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the openers were always horrendous for him. He's also been playing a much more aggressive strategy, and there you go. First Doomguard is in his hand, so let's see if that keeps happening. This is just crazy.
Almost every game in the league, he had such a draw.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Doomguard is a bit better when you have Voidcaller, and
so is Mal'Ganis.
At the same time, he does have the Mal'Ganis, which you'd much rather get into play.
Yeah. So my question to you is, how early do you, like, would you rather get Doomguard early or Mal'Ganis early? I'm guessing Mal'Ganis just because of the value you get immediately and the fact that it might not get removed and you might win on the back of it. But if it takes removal to remove Mal'Ganis, would you rather not lose a Doomguard is my question.
Also, the Hunter deck don't run Hunter's Mark, which is a big deal.
Oh my god.
It's like Gaara's a prophet. This is exactly what he's saying.
You know, Gaara, you're starting to get into the caster curse land. You've got to stop this.
I feel so bad for him because he also looks so sad. Look at him. And he's like, really? Again? I play Zoo. In every game, I have double Doomguard in almost my starting hand. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, it is a little rough there. I mean, to be fair, he did keep Voidcaller Mal'Ganis in his opening hand, which is not going to leave him with a lot of opportunity to hit a good curve. But yeah, after that opening hand, drawing into Doomguard is real rough.
I have to say, I'm a little curious he kept that mulligan. It felt like it's way too slow against a deck that can just snowball early, but...
I definitely agree with you. I think that that's really ambitious, you know, really ambitious keep there. I feel like you need, especially with you know, Warlock in this matchup, you need to be able to actually contest their early minions with your own minions. You know, even if you do get a Mal'Ganis early, if your opponent has board presence and you don't, you know, they can pretty easily kill your Mal'Ganis with Kill Command, they can silence it with an Owl, and then just kill you.
Yeah. I thought he was going to play the Abusive Sergeant for tempo last turn as well. What were you going to say, Gar?
He expected to be lucky. Like, he kept those cards because it's very likely he will draw something, right? Some 2-drop, 1-drop. But he didn't get it, like, in not just that, he got, like, super punished with the double Doomguard draw. And Hunter is like one of those decks that really punishes you for having a bad draw.
Yeah, possibly the deck that punishes you the most, in fact.
Yeah.
Alright, so Freezing Traps on the board from the Mad Scientist.
But that might be like a good draw for his hand, the second Voidcaller.
For his hand, it's actually probably one of the better ones he could have gotten for sure. Like, do you just power overwhelm your stuff and let it know it's useless?
If he gets like an Argus.
Well, and this is actually also sort of illustrative of the problem of keeping the speculative Void Caller Mal'Ganis. You know, even if you do get the opportunity to potentially try and set up, you know, Void Caller into Mal'Ganis, if your opponent has gotten tempo on you and has things like Freezing Trap, you can't even use it.
Right. It's even worse in that case. So he's playing the abusive here in the hopes that he's going to be able to trigger the Freezing Trap with it, or worst case scenario, force the hunter to remove the abusive and fear that Freezing Trap being triggered for almost no cost.
Maybe you also expected... It doesn't make sense. I'm trying to like explain it, like, or try to understand why he went for it. But against a very aggressive hunter, it's also bad. Because Archon, I think... Also, when Xixo played the hunter, he played like super face hunter.
Hybrid and face. Yeah, there's been a mix of both. This is an unusual, like very mid-range one, but you're right. Typically, they do play the more hybrid or face ones.
I don't think that like just Mal'Ganis is enough to just seal the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Iron Beak Owl might sometimes be enough to buy time for the hunter to just push face.
I mean, here, you know, he's able to potentially set up the Mal'Ganis next turn, but he's just at 9. And Zelay has, you know, this big board, and what are you going to do about it? Even if you do get Mal'Ganis in play, he can kill command it, attack a guy into it, and then just kill you.
So, juggler, imp gang boss, attack, trigger the trap, and then power overwhelm the other. No, you kind of want to keep the you kind of want to pop the shredder anyway. I guess if Mal'Ganis sticks, there's a chance.
Oh.
Whoa, okay. So he's taking a really big risk.
That's ambitious.
Yeah, that's, again...
At this point, though, I don't think there's a way that Frozen Ice wins. He doesn't get really lucky here.
And that's out.
And that actually is good for him. You know, now he can attack with... Potentially attack with the Doomguard.
Guaranteed the 2 minions.
Well, he's guaranteed getting 2 minions. He might not get the Mal'Ganis is the problem.
Let's hope for his sake that he does get the Mal'Ganis, because otherwise this is looking very bleak. It's looking any brighter anyway, even with Mal'Ganis.
The thing is, Mal'Ganis is still just gonna die on Zelay's next turn, even if he gets it for free here. Yeah, it looks like Doomguard came into play, and then there's the Mal'Ganis.
That's not too bad. So this
I think
is
you
somewhat
have
helpful.
To push for.
I feel like you have to draw here. And well, that was the perfect draw. But even if Zelay had not drawn that, you know, he's actually still not in a horrible position. He can attack into the Mal'Ganis with a guy, kill command it, play Freezing Trap, you know, send that Doomguard back.
He had lethal anyway, because you could kill command Mal'Ganis, and then, like, he would have been maybe 2 turns from lethal, so I guess Frozen Eyes could have found some more healing. Not that I think his deck runs any, but. Oh well, that's a little unfortunate for Frozen Eyes there with the awful zoo draws every single time he plays the deck. Gar's been keeping track, it seems, over the past few weeks as a result of the entire league. I mean, just one question, by the way, for both of you players. How much do you keep track of all the games that are played, Gara?
I did it for a long time, but I'm switching so many decks. Like, mm-hmm. I'm playing so many different classes and so many decks that I feel like it doesn't make too much sense. Also, with the new expansion, it's kind of like a reset. You kind of have to reset when an expansion comes out, I feel like,
right,
with keeping stats. Like, what's the point in your hunter win ratio of the second season? And, like, when...
You mean River Crocolis is not good anymore? Oh, come on, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see what you mean. It makes sense. Yeah. It makes a lot of sense.
I think that in a lot of cases, you know, when people talk about, you know, keeping track of win rates and things, they don't necessarily account for lots of different stuff. So you can only really put so much stock into them. You know, if you have win rates for vastly different versions of a particular deck. You know, when people talk about Patron Warrior's win rate, you know, over the course of the tournament season or whatever, it's like, well, A, you know, there was a period where Patron Warrior decks were built very poorly. Then there was a period where Patron Warrior decks were built well and other decks weren't built well against them. And then finally, you know, we're at the point where people don't play decks that can't beat Patron Warrior, so Patron Warrior wins a lot less.
Yeah, It kind of makes sense. But like, so basically you're not tracking every single game. You just try to get a broad feeling for what's best. Because we saw your priest, by the way, yesterday in action. And when we initially saw the priest, I called, you know, this deck might go full Titanic on us and everything might just go to hell. But it didn't. I mean, it worked out pretty well as a result of course, maybe the benching played into it. But what was the reasoning behind that? Because priest hasn't exactly been stellar in the league either.
We specifically brought Priest because Tempo Storm had played a significant number of aggressive decks in previous weeks. The other two decks that I had played were Mech Shaman and Ramp Druid, or sort of Midrange Druid. And I didn't like Midrange Druid pretty much, period. I didn't think it had really great win rates across the board against most of what we expected them to play. And Mech Shaman struggles quite a bit against other aggressive decks. So Priest was a deck that we felt like would have a significant number of positive matchups against a lineup that was generally aggro skewed. We actually missed out on one of the good matchups when I lost to Garen's Hunter. Yeah. in the Smork Mirror match. It was actually Smork versus Smelf, so not quite a mirror match. But and then the Warlock turned out to be Handlock instead of Zoo, but we were still able to position it such that we got, to play against one of the strong matchups for the deck.
The good matchups, yeah. All right, so it makes a bit of sense. By the way, the Druid deck turns out, Gaara, you found the source was from Mr. Yagut, who made that token Druid deck, the Tiddler we saw play a little earlier.
All right. He streamed it a few days earlier.
Okay, so from a stream directly to the tournament, turns out Tiddler believes in the token Druid. But then again, it's fun to experiment when there's really nothing much at stake besides maybe having a little bit of fun and sportsmanship. So it seems like 6-0 versus Frozen Ice here. Rogue, I'd expect 6-0 to be playing the maybe more weapon-heavy Rogue that he's been bringing week after week. And Frozen Ice, do you pin him on a slow mage deck since he's been playing so much aggression, Gaara?
Tiddla used to be their mage player, right? For Celestial. I mean, the Asian players really tend to go for the hyper-aggressive tempo mage, not just like the normal Flamemaker version, the one with like Ice Block and Pyroblast and missiles and a lot of burst damage. But the Freeze Mage is just like the safest pick by far.
This hand does not look very aggressive.
Yeah, no. It's looking like he's going to live up to his name and he's just going to freeze everything.
I still don't get it. Is there a type of ice that is not, in fact, frozen?
Like, yeah, I was asking myself that question. I mean, how do you freeze ice? Is there, like, a level where it becomes, like, super ice? I was asking myself the exact question yesterday. I guess not.
Apparently, this is the level when you actually have Mad Scientist and Ice Bear and Ice Block in the same hand. You are now.
Okay, so you're like, you've got frozen ice. I get it.
Yeah.
So if you stack Ice Bear and ice Block.
Exactly. Okay. Oh. It's just to tell us what deck is playing. This guy's toast.
I can't wait. One day we'll have like an entire arsenal of ice-oriented spells that you can literally make Freeze Mage. It's gonna be nothing but cards that freeze. Give it like 3 years.
There is Ice Rager 2 now. You can put that in the Freeze Mage.
Oh man, the Ice Rager.
It's really OP. Power creep, duh.
I know, right?
But Frozen Ice really likes to draw terrible. He drew like already, he already has 3 secrets and no card draw. Yeah, he has Pyroblast.
His draw is quite good.
Pyroblast and 2 secrets in his hand. That's like the worst draw you can have.
So you think he likes
this? This is the worst draw.
That would make it worse.
Yeah, Frozen Ice isn't exactly getting the. I think he's got the worst draw in the entire league in every single week that he's played, I think.
He's like an entire hand with useless cards. Pay
attention, class. Yeah, Force and Style.
He can't even fireball it or anything. Like, it's 100% useless.
He's gonna find the fireball though, right? Oh, more useless stuff.
Wow.
Oh, this is not looking... I don't think Frozen Ice's exit day is gonna look as exciting as he might have hoped for.
Yeah, this is just sad. I mean, that antique heal bot, he even has Ice Barrier in place, so he can't even play it to heal for quite a few turns. It's just not going to do anything.
Yeah, you can't even get, 2 health out of it. It's just going to do nothing for another round. But then again, if you look at the amount of health gain he's got, if somehow his draw picks up right now, at least he'll be able to clear the board and then recover immediately. So...
I'm pretty sure, like, overall, Frozen Ice was the unluckiest player in the tournament in terms of draws.
I mean, that is reflected in his record. So
Yeah. I think that the record would support that statement. Like, assuming you start saying that you don't see too many misplays, which I think you'd be right. Frozen Ice hasn't exactly been playing super poorly. It's just that when the draws don't line up in a field that's as stacked as this one, it can really show in your record. Yeah. Oh, man. And the worst part is that he's not the only one suffering from it. The entire team suffers from the bad draws of one player.
Mm-hmm. And they keep sending him out. Poor guy.
Is he benched, again, actually, man, after this? No.
If he does lose this game, yeah, which looks like he quite well will, he will end up being benched.
And Sixo already has, like, the lower tap heal bot for this matchup.
Oh, I mean, yeah, Sixo's hand is great.
Yeah. That's an early low tab. Wants to make sure he keeps his board alive to push for even more damage before Frozen Ice starts actually stalling the board.
Yeah, it's really strong. Low tab is only... Yeah, low tab is good in turn 5, 6, 7. On 8 and 9, he's bad. And in 10,
the value of low tab drops dramatically, other than as a, you know, prevent your opponent from killing you part of the against Freeze Mage, once your opponent can just cast Frost Nova into it and largely negate the effect.
Mad Scientist here giving absolutely no secrets at all, because the ice block's already set up and the two ice bears have been eaten through. So again, Frozen Ice keeping up the bad draws. You gotta stay consistent with the game plan is what I think. That's how I look at this.
He's waiting to get his Frost Giant, I think. That's part of his freeze deck, is the Frost. He's gonna use his hero power as much as possible. You know, he's not
a double Frost Giant. Yeah,
exactly.
I see it.
Eventually, he's gonna play two 8/8s in the same turn.
Oh man, Kibler, what if Frost Giant Echo of Medivh deck actually makes its way into the meta? Well, that should be like super nice, because you don't even have to be on low health. You can be like in max health and do it.
That would surprise me.
Right.
But it would be pretty cool.
Of course. Gaara, you're going to be showing me some of that Freeze Mage with Frost Giant. You're the one I rely on, you know, for those cool decks in tournament settings.
Actually, Mage is like the number one contendant together with Controller for the Frozen Giant. Like, just in general. Also because of the Kuldara Drake and stuff. Other classes just seem to struggle to get the Frozen Giant or Frost Giant out.
Mm-hmm.
Because they will not use the hero power so much.
Yeah, there's a couple... Like, you want to be playing a class... In order to use Frost Giant, you want to be playing a class that is actually generating, like, meaningful value to get you to the end game with the Frost Giant, which is why, you know, Mage being able to actually control the board with his hero power and Warrior being able to keep itself alive. I think Priest, too... is a reasonable contender, because they don't have anything to do on turn 2 most of the time anyway. So,
yeah. So I want to bring your attention to the fact that this game might actually turn around very soon. If the board is locked down by Frozen Ice and he picks up even just a Fireball and he can extend the game for a few more turns, more likely than not, and possibly turn it around. Like, it doesn't look that hopeless anymore.
Yeah, this is looking a lot better. Zixo, he actually has a pretty awkward hand at this point.
Yep.
You know, the pair of sprints when he already has a pretty full hand are not super exciting. And I mean, when Freeze Mage does get to the late game, which, you know, Frozen Ice has managed to do, it is a very powerful deck. And it looks like Tiddler just opens Cenarius. We saw that down in the corner. But
oh man, that's for the new token druid.
Yeah, he's actually just getting ready to update his deck right now. I am ready
to learn. They're gonna throw him out again. Send Tiddler out for a second round. Oh, that's a lot of burst though. This is never mind. Maybe Frozen Ice is gonna have a little bit of a rougher time in a minute.
Yeah, I mean those sprints, while they weren't doing anything right away, we were saying, you know, this looked like a game that was likely to go on longer, and that does give Sixo time to find that burst with Sprint. You know, when your opponent is freezing your board and blowing it up every turn, you don't have much to do other than dig for better cards.
So what does Frozen Ice really need here? Like, I guess a Frostbolt would go a long way to winning the game. Because the moment Alexstrasza falls down, and Sixo can't just pop the block without dealing with Alex.
Mm-hmm.
And he might even be afraid of doing so without playing Healbot. So he's going to have to both heal and remove Alex at the same time. As soon as Frozen Ice plays it.
Usually you just zap Alex in this matchup.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ha, this guy's toast.
It would be so funny if Rosen Ice just keeps drawing all burst spells now and just wins the game.
Yeah, that's kind of what I'm thinking about. Like, if that happens, that could just be...
It's a fireball!
Yeah. That's step one, so... Set up that rogue for a good kill. You could even... You can't quite kill your own mad scientist, unfortunately. Unless you drop it with Doomsayer. Oh!
He has to fireball the 6-2. I wonder. Or is he just gonna Ice Lance it?
Really? I would go Alex Face and...
Yeah, can't you Alex your opponent... And potentially Ice Lance the 6-2 protect, you know, potentially protect
the,
your block.
The big problem is he can't get the second block out. He has to fireball his own mad scientist, and
that's
right
true.
Now 6-0 can already proc the block. What to do? Mm-hmm. What you need two turns at least to kill him if 6-0 doesn't have a healbot. But you usually after sprint you expect him to have the healbot. So he's in a really bad situation. He has to clear the board. And probably use defensive Alexstrasza after Xixo procs the block and then tries to grind out a rook with the Alexstrasza. Because a rook usually can't really kill it, has to invest a lot.
I mean, Xixo already has a 7 attack weapon, so he does have means to potentially kill an Alexstrasza actually fairly easily. Speaking of 7...
Yeah, like a Blade Fury is going to be an issue on its own, so...
Yeah, but he kind of has to use the dagger if he wants to proc the block.
Yeah. Can he break? Can he proc the block with flurry this turn? If he like backstab, tinker, attack, break it.
He could he could pop the block. Yeah, he could because he's gonna pop the block, but he's gonna be on 9 health at the end of it.
Right.
So leaving your opponent 9 health after a blade flurry with your double tinkers gone is really risky unless you've got maybe the double this rate already set up.
Mm-hmm. His opponent is that a poor increment for him to be doing this. Well, it is a big part of it is just that you know the obviously the weapon and blade flurry do damage in such big chunks that it's difficult.
Ooh, wow, that's so much damage.
Big card in the matchup.
Yeah, I loved Sixto's inclusion of the Assassin's Blade in just about every rogue list he's been playing. We saw him with playing it recently where it just didn't do much, unfortunately for him. But when it works, there's almost no counter in the metagame right now because Harrison Jones is Blade, but it's still a one of. And the matchups against which Assassin's Blade works are more numerous, I guess, than the ones where it doesn't. And people are playing the Harrison Jones.
Yeah, it is a very powerful card when your opponents can't get rid of it. And you're able to, you know, have the time to leverage the sort of card advantage or damage that it's able to generate.
This is pretty much over. I think the hope of going Alexstrasza to the face and top decking is where we'll win might have been the only play that could have maybe turned this around. Because he wanted to play the long game, but I don't think in this case it was realistic.
That was sort of my thought process, you know, when I mentioned that last turn was I don't know, you know, you don't reliably have the tools to actually be able to win the game post Alexstrasza, but you also are in a really bad position if you don't play Alexstrasza. You know, like your opponent just sprinted and you don't really have, you haven't been drawing cards, you have a very small hand. It's very difficult from that position to actually find the tools that you need to close out the game. Or even just survive.
Alright, so Xixo's going to navigate this very carefully, make sure that he doesn't make any blunders on the way to the face.
I mean, he can proc the block, but what is he thinking about?
Probably an Alexstrasza. Like, would Alexstrasza be a problem? The answer to that, I think, is no, because really, like, you still have a full-on...
You have such a huge... Whoa. You can just go for the dagger plus oil and then proc it.
Yeah, is there even a drawback to that? Because you can sap Alex if it, well, that's kind of mediocre if you're trying to burst, but...
I don't see any downside to that. It's his second oil as well, and he used also one deadly poison.
Oh, that's so evil. Sapping the Acolyte of Pain. Thou shalt not draw.
Yeah, now Frozen is in a position where... There's not only lethal attackers in play, but also just a lethal weapon. So even if he is able to Blizzard or Flame Strike or something, And he's gonna he's able to actually
strike ice block is his only out, right?
Yeah, I believe he's actually able to kill him through Alexstrasza as well. So
yeah, that's just nothing.
Yeah, I can't really see how he's gonna be able to win from this position. If he gets a
ice block to live one turn, I guess.
Ice block, and then he can play Doomsayer and not die right away. There's ice block, so he's not dead this turn.
Yeah, the ice block's
not
gonna
live through the next one.
That's somewhat convenient, but I still don't see the win. So
maybe using Harrison.
Oh wow, the dream. You're still dead though, right? Like Harrison Jones.
Heal bot.
Oh wow.
I don't even know. Even if you could like choose cards from the entire card pool, you would still lose.
Yeah. I don't think it would help. I don't think it will help very much right now. Yeah, he's gonna set his opponent down to where Assassin's Blade hit will take him out next turn. What does Frozen Ice find? I mean, he could win Fatigue at this point, I think. Like, if you wanted, Sixo could just push his opponent to Fatigue and win.
I think that's actually possible.
Yeah. Do you stab the Doomsayer? Just to rub it in. No, you kill it. Okay, replace the weapon.
I mean, he has the Assassin's Blade there, yeah. So.
Who cares, not, right?
Yeah.
Oh! He's alive! This is insanely slow.
He is alive this turn.
Yeah. Death by a billion cuts. This is sounding like right now.
This is just prolonging the inevitable at this point. I really can't think of a sequence of draws where Frozen Ice is able to come back into this game. Maybe there's like
Couple flame strikes.
Into third ice block into
if he runs double flame strike, double heal bot, and draws
that
like
could actually,
the ice barriers, like the second ice barrier.
He's already played both early game. They're already gone. That's the thing.
Oh, is this lethal?
I can't do math, so I'm gonna leave it to you.
6, 7, 8. 12, I think this is lethal.
With the Blade Flurry? And the Sousy deck hand for good measure. Just for good measure.
Boom.
Yeah, there is in fact no secret at the top there, that was a little bit of a mistake. So Frozen Eyes did in fact lose to the Rogue player. So how would you say this is, as far as your expectations of Rogue versus Freeze Mage, do you think this is something that you should expect from the matchup because of the amount of burst, or...
I mean, typically Freeze Mage is very strong against Rogue. Assassin's Blade definitely does change things a little bit because it gives you more reliable damage that is unable to be frozen quite as easily. So you're able to, you know, potentially win through Novas and things like that. But overall, I still think, generally speaking, the Freeze Mage is usually favored, assuming their draws aren't quite as bad as Frozen Ice's.
Yeah. Is there, like, any tech card you play? Yeah, Gar, go ahead.
I think so. It's similar to Mech Shaman, where you play the Doomhammer. Freeze Mage can't really do much against this like long-term, overall, sick amount of damage, and Assassin's Blade is similar to it. So I guess he teched for the Freeze Mage matchup and some others. So usually Freeze Mage is favored, but I think Xyxos Rogue is a little bit better.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, makes sense. I think that's it's a good call too, because we've seen so much Freeze Mage in the metagame on this exact championship. Everybody's been bringing it because it's bound to run into a good matchup at least once in the entire series. So I think that's a good call from Team Archon overall to bring that. Now onwards to the Team Archon's in a pretty good position. They've got two players with one win, which means if Firebat gets a win, then they're going to be able to navigate this without fear of being benched, necessarily. Whereas Team Celestial could still, you know, run into a worse situation because Frozen Ice is already benched. So Soundstorm being benched would allow Team Archon to target the Patron. Although, can you even target Patron?
That stamp gives me nightmares, by the way.
Does it? After yesterday, I can imagine. Yeah, we didn't even think about it. You know, starting Team League, we didn't expect we'd ever need like a triple bench thing to just put over the entire team. But for the first time yesterday, it happened to the Temple Store. Man, that must have felt so crushing.
I was sure to take a screenshot of it, you know, so
you
for
did?
Posterity's sake. Oh, yes.
Okay. Well, that's... That's what we call rubbing it in. So Gar, do you really think there's any merit to really be worried about benching rule? Like, is it that problematic most of the time, or is that like a unique case you ran into yesterday?
Definitely, because your opponents can just like pick much better into your remaining decks. So getting benched, especially, I'm trying to figure out if it's like worse later on. Probably it is worse because it's like easier, even easier to target the remaining decks if they have only like two decks available, like it was for us.
Yeah, I think it becomes more relevant at the end, right?
It definitely matters though.
Oh, it's a big deal. It was a huge part of our win yesterday was our ability to sort of navigate the matchups after the benching. When you know we were able to queue specifically Freeze Mage and Priest without having to worry about playing against Patron Warrior, for instance. It definitely played a big deal in our victory there. And I think there's actually quite a bit of sort of mind game style stuff that goes on with the deck selection. You know, in some cases, you'll try and queue something because, oh, well, they're not likely to play this person because they risk being benched. But at the same time, you know, if you think that, then I think that, then, you know, obviously you can try and line up sort of next level thinking to get better matchups.
Yeah. So there's the Deadly Poison and Blade Flurry for Silent Storm. That's really important against the patron deck. You can at least negate one wave of patrons. And if you can get the tempo on the back of that, maybe come back in the match. It's pretty rough to go through all the armor once it gets stacked up, right?
I think that Silent Storm has, by the way, also really impressive stats overall. One of the most impressive stats in the tournament because he's 8-8 in score. And their team is 0-7.
Yeah, no, like, he definitely, like, in relative to everything that happened, I think you're definitely right.
I mean, that's crazy, right? To not have a negative win ratio.
Yeah, when you're basically the entire team is Sandstorm's demise, right? Like that, he can say, you know, I did my job, guys. This is all on you. I did what I had to.
Trump was our team's workhorse. He played the most games in the league by a fair margin.
Yeah, who couldn't put you out, right? Like Brian Keebler had to stay behind the lines. Yeah.
All right. So here, I mean, this is a pretty good board overall. I mean, like. For the Patron Warrior, you want the game to be sort of extending here against the Rogue. You don't want to get sort of, you know, abused by early minions. Though right now, you know, Zalay doesn't really have the tools to sort of set up a big burst kill. You know, he doesn't have any real card draw. He doesn't have Emperor. And the Rogue deck is one of the best at actually dealing with the sort of big grim Patron boards because it does naturally have Blade Flurry for good clears.
What now? It's so funny how all the patron lists cycle around all the time. I feel like Zalay gets so annoyed by everyone copying his list that he always goes and changes the list after every week because now he plays double Taskmaster again. And that was like one of the first cards you cut in the patron.
Yeah, I was going to comment on that as well. Taskmaster has been a card that sort of has fallen out of favor, generally speaking, in patron lists. You know, in part because it doesn't actually draw you cards. You know, so many of the cards in patron are about sort of cycling to find your, you know, key components. And right now, you know, this is one of those situations where Zalay has a bunch of stuff, but all he can do with it is make a couple of patrons. And this is a matchup where that strategy is actually pretty weak.
Mm-hmm. You know, it reminds me of the all-in Miracle Rogues back in the days where they just played card draw. And then eventually it transitioned a little bit towards maybe playing more minions. You know, you started seeing Violet Teachers coming out, which was like, you know, a really big revolution. Earthrending Farseers got included. Like a lot of things changed about the deck and it became less spell-centric. And it seems like Patron is always hovering between the two, you know, extremes where you either just push for draw a lot, even including shield blocks, to compensate for the amount of damage that you would take. Instead of putting removal, you're just putting in shield block to cycle and stay alive. And maybe just playing more minions. And Cool Taskmaster is pretty okay against aggro, so I can understand why you'd play that.
Early on, we saw quite a few... hey, there's another Cool Taskmaster. It's the theme of our game right now. But early on, you know, you'd see quite a few, like Loot Hoarders, for instance, was a very popular card in the Patron Warrior decks. That's largely fallen out of favor because of the value of Unstable Ghoul as sort of a combo piece And you really need this balance of, you know, okay, how many combo pieces can I actually generate versus, how many cards can I have that actually draw me to those, and how much interaction do I need to actually stay alive to get to that point?
So I'm liking this play here from Zelay, getting an extra bit of damage on this Cruel Taskmaster. He so desperately needs to cycle. I can't really fault him for that, I think.
He gets to draw two cards here.
We're in a
and there's another
like,
Battle Rage.
Do you take it, or your patrons will just carry you to victory once you get that Battle Rage off?
I mean, I wonder if he's better off saving that Battle Rage until because he has Whirlwind and Patron in hand.
Yeah.
And he's not really under a ton of pressure. He's got a pretty high life total. So I'm not an expert patron player by any means, and Zelay is certainly very experienced, but I might have been tempted to keep it until you can get a really big card draw with that, but maybe he has enough of the components that he's looking for that he just wants to find the ones that he's missing.
Yeah, his hand sucks. He had to go for the draw. Double Enraged Taskmaster, Patron, Vorax, it's like Whirlwind, all dead cards.
Yeah, it's like one wave, right? Yeah.
Well, there's another Whirlwind.
He's missing a lot.
Like, yeah, he's missing Warsong Commander. Yeah, like the thing is, the first wave of patrons. Yeah, the first wave of patrons does very little in this case because you're kind of expecting to get Blade Flurried off the board. So you'll push for a bit of damage, but if you can't seal the game afterwards, maybe it just doesn't even matter that you got that first wave out.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you also have to worry at this point too if you use something like Death Spite and attack into the Lotheb with your Taskmaster. You're taking quite a bit of damage here. You're taking five from this. And he's just gonna go with the Taskmaster to remove it right away. Okay, that makes more sense than trading off his Taskmaster on board if he is trying to set up a big board to sort of build up that combo. But now he's at 19, and Silent Storm has quite a bit of burst possibility with Tinkers and Flurry.
Baldur is it feels so bad in this matchup. Just because he's gotta be trying to bait something here. Otherwise, this is potentially suicide when you play too many spells or it's on the board.
Flurry. So if there's a Frothing, but still no Warsong.
Yeah, and he also has no card draw, like he can't just play Gnomish Inventors or anything to just have something on the board. So he's kind of forced to go for the patrons, but he really knows it will just get wiped down.
I have to wonder what exactly Zelay cut to make room for Cruel Taskmasters here. We haven't seen Unstable Ghouls from him this game, which is one of the cards that's sort of in a similar place. It's kind of a combo enabler, kind of a that can also be a defensive creature. He's missing a lot of key components at the moment.
This is such a combo. Like, the moment you top deck Emperor Thorazin into Warsong Commander, you're golden, but those have to kind of be your next two draws. Or at least an Acolyte of Pain to enable in some way. He's going to try to push for the Patron board. Can't fault him for it. He saw the Deadly Poison go away, so he's hoping maybe the entire turn of his opponent will consist of clearing. And maybe then he'll be able to do something.
I also expected him to go face and go for the execute just to get as much damage in as possible.
Yeah.
He's really hoping to get Warsong and then kill him with the Warsong frothing double Whirlwind. Usually two Whirlwind effects are enough to just kill your opponent.
Yeah. I saw RDU playing yesterday, I think, in HPL. Oh man, that was excruciating. His opponent killed two of his own patrons to deny RDU one damage off lethal with the frothing. That was just a great play. Yeah, I think people sometimes underestimate maybe the following up with your own frauding with your own patrons, because very frequently in the the mirror match you abuse your opponent's patrons to buff up your own frauding, and that's something very few people think about.
Oh god, he didn't get this. Is like the problem. You wanna
wow.
Like the thing with patron is you wanna draw all your card draw cards early and all the combo pieces later, like you want to draw into your combo pieces, and he drew all the combo pieces early and no card draw. The only card draw he got was the double battle rage, and he drew like more combo pieces with it, and then he just can't draw cards. Like, he really needs to draw cards.
That was brutal. That Blade Flurry pickup was basically game, right? Game ending.
You just push face and win. That's it.
I was actually thinking that it was. I wasn't even thinking about the fact that it ended the game, but I was thinking that even if you just killed those two fucking berserkers, the game was just going to be over because there's no burst left for delay.
Literally
ends the game.
Kibla too fast in doing maths.
Oh, that's it. Lethal. Right there.
Yeah, well, I knew it was ending the game in some fashion. I wasn't really paying enough attention to the life totals, but no. Silent Storm picks up the match, Rogue taking out Patient Warrior and evening up the series.
Yep, so that's no one's checkmark yet, though. This, two wins, sometimes you already have somebody checkmarked out of the entire series. But now, basically, I think it'll come down to who gets the next win. Either it's Frozen Ice or Firebat to get the entire team on one win, and then no fear of bench ever again. So it's less, easy to target you. So maybe the two players who will be sent out are going to be Firebat versus Frozen Ice in some fashion. I'm not sure if either of the matchups they get is good. I think Firebat could be happy to play Druid against Frozen Ice's lineup, though.
Yeah, I mean, Druid is certainly a class that I like playing as Freeze Mage in particular. I'm not usually a huge fan of playing Druid against either version of Warlock. Unless you have a significant number of big game hunters, I tend to find that the Handluck matchup is rough, and Zoo certainly is as well. You really need to have a good start to be able to keep up with what they're able to do in the board. And even, sort of modern versions of Zoo have a lot of late game that can actually ultimately beat you, even if you do get to your own big minions. Mal'Ganis can always end the game. One thing, we talked a little bit earlier about the fact that Celestial does not have a hunter on their squad. I didn't even notice until now that Archon doesn't have a Warlock.
Oh my god, you're right.
Yeah, Warrior, Warlock, and Hunter have been the three most played classes. Pretty much every team, every lineup has included those three. And we're actually seeing, a team without one of each of them. And I'm curious about the rationale behind that on each side.
Yeah, Galra, do you have any insight? Like, have you ever discussed maybe with Temple of Storm not bringing Warlock?
Yeah, honestly, Warlock, is even above Warrior. I think Warlock is the biggest no-brainer class to bring. Because even there's, Hunter. So many. Yeah. Warrior, Warlock, and Mage are, the three strongest classes. Hunter is, the fourth. I can kind of see to not bring Hunter, but when you bring six decks, I mean, it's almost a no-brainer to bring Hunter as well. Because it's just too strong, but yeah. Warlock is really so powerful that I also think it is the top two performing class also, maybe. I think Warlock
probably. I think Hunter and Warlock are the top of the performance as far as win rates. Rogue is pretty high as well. I also the lowest don't think of course that, being Druid. So
I also think that no team regretted ever bringing any type of Warlock so far. To the tournament.
Yeah, that's a great point. Nihilim regretted for sure probably not bringing Hunter yesterday. So I hope Team Archon doesn't regret not bringing Warlock today, because Team Nihilim almost got 6-2 yesterday as a result of maybe not bringing it.
I also think that almost everything, every deck got swept at some point. I think it was LA with Patron. It was me with Hunter, but also some other players with Hunter. Then Druid, of course, but also Freeze Mage. But I think Warlock was the only class that didn't lose five games or whatever. I can't remember. Yeah.
Well, it looks like a Patron versus Druid. What do you think of this matchup, Gara? Do you think Druid can even take it? How?
Statistics say Druid is 57% favorite.
Okay, so Druid has an edge. But without Wild Growth and Innervate, do you think it still has an edge?
No.
Okay, that's good to know. I had to ask, after the beginning of the game, what's your thoughts now that everything's not, you're not going in blind?
I mean, looking at these two hands, I actually like Firebat's hand a lot more. Right now, Tiddler is really short on action, and Firebat has a good curve. He has that shade into Shredder. I mean, one of the big things when you don't have Wild Growth or Innervate is that so many of your cards sort of don't curve out well. But despite having no ramp, Firebat was actually able to play, good three into good four and sort of set things up reasonably. He doesn't have a five, though, and now Tiddler is able to actually sort of, clear most of his damage off the board, and here's where Firebat's going to kind of run into running out of action.
Yeah. I think having the Harrison for the first Deathbite is as important as drawing Innervate or Wild Growth.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is the turn where you could just play the turn 5 patrons if they inner raid.
Yeah, you can just lose. If there's a patron here, the game can basically just be over. Druid doesn't really have good ways to deal with that at all. Looks like Tiller is going for the clear on those two and battle raging himself. Trying to pick up a couple more cards.
And yeah, he will have to answer to that Emperor Thorsen very shortly. So I guess Ancient of War is a great card. If there's no execute for it, you're going to be in a great spot. But Firebat didn't get, say, a Druid of the Claw mid-game to really bait that execute. Very often, that's what you're looking to do. So your Ancient of War can usually tank a lot of damage, if not just be a complete roadblock for the Patron Warrior.
I'm guessing we're going to see Slam into Death's Bite, yeah.
The health totals are looking a little bit low, but...
Yeah. Tiddler's actually taking quite a bit of damage here, and the fact that Firebat has now Force Roar and Double Swipe...
That is crazy burst. I think he could actually just win on the back of those two. He doesn't even have to draw anything else, just full face with everything he's got, and unless Tiddler picks up a crazy Patron Armorsmith turn, this could just be it. No executes for the Dr. Boom is also a problem.
Man, I wonder if you play... Armorsmith, I guess you can't really play Armorsmith Acolyte. You know, you can play Armorsmith Acolyte, attack with the Death's Bite maybe, and then you can Battle Rage, hope to draw, you know, several more cards, and find an execute to kill Dr. Boom. Or maybe just,
first you,
looks like he may just Battle Rage straight up.
Because the Boombots could just clear a
right, board. That's true. There is the opportunity that Boombots, now it looks like he's gonna go a little bit more...
Is he gonna tech the Dr. Boom?
It looks like he's gonna face tank it. That unless he's trying to find an execute off the top, and there it is.
I'm a little confused by his choice to play the two minions and then Battle Rage. Who's gonna Battle Rage in the first place?
Like, is he just not going to proc the Death Spite because he wants to get that frauding value? It's looking like it, right?
Also, he could draw patrons.
He's dead. He's dead. That's it. Game.
Is he not using a Death Spite?
I think he's dead, that's it, like, game over.
He is certainly dead to Force Roar here.
He's exact lethal, actually, that's exactly it.
And, yeah. Boom.
Well, that was pretty good. I guess, Gaur, you were right, you know, the edge was still on the Druid side. The matchup analysis was spot on.
Yeah, Tiddler didn't really have the patron turn to go with his Death Spike, and Firebat, you know, like we said at the beginning, had a pretty good curve that he was able to put a lot of pressure on Tiddler, and then, you know, Force Roar with the Boombots closes things out from 20.
I just wonder, though, if the draw from Tiddler wasn't just that bad, because it looked kind of okay to me. Like, there was nothing awful about the draw, right? He had the weapon, could actually handle the Shade. What did he need to really make this...
Patrons.
Grim Patron. Yeah, he needed Grim Patron.
So you have like one patron here. You think he could have won though, because my concern was that with a double swipe in Firebat's hand, maybe that would have been also pretty difficult. Just like getting them out turn 5 would have been more than enough.
And swipe is pretty bad against Grim Patron.
Like, yeah, of course. Yeah. Of course, it's awful.
It doesn't do anything. Double swipe is even worse.
Yeah.
Yeah. If he was able to get patron out in 5, attack with Death Spite, generate patron, you know, inner raid, generate patrons. Then, you know, he's able to potentially play Armorsmith and, you know, start going kind of crazy with Patron, Whirlwind, Psych Effects, big Battle Rages, and just really start going off.
So I guess ultimately, like, even if the matchup is favored for the Druid, just the Patron alone can make the game. I guess it's always the same issue you run into when you're playing Patrons against, you know, Druid is one of the decks that runs into that issue. But another Patron Warrior also has that problem, where the first one to get the Patrons on the board just takes the game because there's no efficient removal for them. So looking at this, I think Team Archon's in a great position. Got their players spread out.
Yeah, they're up one game currently, but you know, one game could be a really big deal because of your ability to, you know, like you said, kind of spread out your players and be able to set up matches and be less vulnerable to benching here. And Firebat Mage against Silent Storm Paladin. Firebat has played a lot of Freeze Mage in his day, so I have to assume that's what it is, which is usually pretty good against most Paladin lists.
Yeah, I think it's good against every Paladin list, just because it's so hard for them to get something that sticks. We saw Strivecrow yesterday win the matchup against a Freeze Mage, and that on its own was just mind-blowing. It's not something that I expect to see very often. Like,
I
just
think I've
actually
seen Strivecrow beat Freeze Mage twice in this this league.
He cheats. He's a cheater. That's it. He knows his deck's
head. There's something fishy going on there.
I think so. It's just so scary.
But if anyone can do it, it's probably Silent Storm. I think right now Silent Storm is the best control Paladin player. He got rank 1 with it on NA.
So he knows the matchup inside and out, I guess. At the very least, that's the case.
And here we have a pretty reasonable draw from both players. A little bit a little bit poor from Silent Storm without much in the way of good aggression here. Peacekeeper doesn't really have many targets in this matchup anyways, it's just a 3-3.
We saw yesterday an amazing moment that could have made history where Strivecrow could have used Aldor and a Doomsayer to kill his own Sylvanas on it to then steal Archmage Antonidas, but he didn't do it. So that could have been a really interesting thing against Freeze Mage to find a target for the Aldor, but we didn't get to witness the rarity.
I did see that. It was a pretty entertaining moment. Mm-hmm. Sadly, it didn't happen, but...
Yeah. Well, looks like Sunstorm is going to have to start trying to chip away at the mage. The thing is, it takes you a long time. Even if you have like optimal damage output draws as a paladin, it's still going to take you forever. And on turn 3, if you've got almost no damage dealt to the mage, and he's going to start curving, like, we see that Firebat's hand is not terrible at all. Like, he's got card draw, he's got a Nova Doomsayer, both of which are very good against Paladin. There's, like, no worry for him to get wiped out of this.
Yeah, and here, the fact that that's a big game hunter rather than something like a Piloted Shredder is a pretty big deal. You know, not only is it much more vulnerable to removal, but it is also... also just, not able to stick around if it is sort of cleared. It's two health minion, and the stickiness of the Paladin Shredder comes in really handy in this matchup. And this is exactly the wrong order. Silent Storm draws his Paladin Shredder on turn 5.
Overkilling that 2-4 Lulu Hoarder. Oh man, that must feel so bad.
I think it really comes down to how well the mage draws, and not so much how well the Paladin draws. Like, yeah. If the mage gets the Doomsayer and Novas early, and all the card draw cards, there's really not so much the Paladin can do. There's not much player interaction in this matchup.
Yeah, I agree. I think the mage just waits for the perfect opportunity, then, 1-2 punches his opponent. But he's looking for that 1-2 punch, and if he doesn't find it, then that's what determines the entire match. Oh, that's a pretty good swing card, though.
I definitely agree with that, but I do think it's also pretty important, if the Paladin's draw is pretty bad, then they give the mage so much time, and... Because you have a hero power that's, this attrition thing. And right now, we look at this and, Firebat is over 30. And we're on, getting into turn 6. And Silent Storm doesn't even have a particularly good board. He has some okay stuff. But at this point, if he had that shredder that stuck around, if he had, had either a second shredder or a reasonable 5, he'd actually be putting on meaningful pressure, but now he just doesn't have much going on, and Firebat has a lot of time to piece everything together. The one thing that Firebat doesn't have is a good removal effect besides this Doomsayer, and Silent Storm does have that Owl. So, this could actually be Owl your Doomsayer into Lotheb.
That's a pretty good way to log the board, yeah.
I mean, he hasn't put on enough pressure for this to be, a really big swing turn that actually puts Firebat in a position where he, is likely to actually die next turn. He can't even pop Ice Block if it was in play. But it is definitely, a good turn for Silent Storm, even if it's not gonna likely end the game. Looks like Firebat's debating whether he wants to kill an Owl or a
potential 3-3. Yeah,
playing around the possibility of Quartermaster.
Well, it's a lot of damage coming from the Paladin, but still not quite enough. And I like, there's a chance that he just doesn't get to ever deal that damage. Mm-hmm. But Firebat needs to find an AoE still, though.
Yeah, that's a really weird hand for the amount of cards he has. He has, like, no freezing effects.
Yeah, exactly. No Nova, no Blizzard. I guess you can set up Ice Block, Arcane Intellect, and then see where that leads you. Because I think he's still pretty far ahead, now that Lothab's out of the way. And all he needs to do is Alex his opponent on a good turn. Oh,
and there's Blizzard.
That'll solve the problem.
That buys quite a bit of time.
Yeah.
But you kind of need to set up Alex, but he cannot set up Alex. Mm-hmm. I think there's still enough damage to proc the block. I mean, to kill him. There's no block out yet.
Yeah, it's gonna feel a bit scary though, because Firebat knows that he's gonna be like, this is a position where you're Freeze Mage, where you're scrambling to get your secrets out and trying to set up an Axe Jaws turn, and it's really meta inefficient. If you haven't played Emperor prior to that, it's very difficult sometimes to weave everything in for multiple turns in a row. So maybe that's what's gonna happen with Firebat. I don't wish it upon him, but I've seen it.
I mean, Silent Storm knows after Alexstrasza he's dead. He has no Leon Hands or no heal at all, so he has to prevent the Alex from coming out. And this is like the best way to do it with his current hand. Shredder can't be pinged.
Oh my goodness, that's the top deck to rule them all from Firebat.
That is definitely quite good, but it looks like he's going with Ice Block.
That's weird.
So if he were to, say, ping the
the shield,
Minibot and Flame Strike, that would leave just
7 damage on the board with the Whirling Zap-O-Matic.
There you can see, actually, usually between turn 3 and turn 6, your task as a Freeze Mage is usually to get to set up the Ice Block or any other secret. Now you see the problem. He can like use Blizzard or Flame Strike, but he can't set up the secret, which is a problem. And now he can't play the Alexstrasza. Like, he can't play
because
Alexstrasza
because he has to play the secret, exactly. Which that is why you need... go ahead, sorry.
That ordering from Firebat was really weird. He played his... I guess he maybe had 10 cards in hand at the beginning of that turn. I'm just trying to figure out why... Yeah, he must have had 10 cards in hand.
Yeah.
That makes a lot more sense, because I was looking at it and I was like, oh, he cast Ice Block then AI'd and hit Blizzard, which he likely would have wanted to cast that turn. But the fact that he would have overdrawn with the Arcane Intellect means that it was not sort of an out of order sequence.
So Firebat here has got to be a little worried about a potential 4 damage coming out, which would be another True Silver or double Consec.
Yeah,
but
I think that...
if that's what you lose to, then I guess so be it, right?
Looks like Firebat won if he if the turn. Silent Storm doesn't get like Leon Hands.
Yeah, it's looking very grim for Silent Storm. And even then, I think Firebat could escalate the Fireballs and the Pyroblast over 2 turns and still win it. Unless I'm mistaken, he just like Emperor Thorsen. No, maybe not. He needed like a Healbot on top. And now that's the question, right? How much do you play around Leon Hands? Because that's a really big issue.
He can't. In this position, I don't think you can anymore. You have to go for Alex and kill him in 2 turns. You have the block in your hand. Next turn, Ice Block, Fireball, and then Pyroblast win. If he has lose, you heal, you lose. Because if he freezes now, he has... Like, when do you play the Alexstrasza? You can't... Like, you... It's like the best turn to play Alexstrasza.
What if you Blizzard Doomsayer?
But he has 4 life. He gets the weapon.
Yeah, I know.
He can always proc the block. That's the thing. He's so low on life that it's like the only play. You can only go for this play if you can protect your Ice Block somehow.
Right.
Yeah, and that's just not going to happen. Like, choose over champion, double Consec, again, the same threat as they were there last turn, but except you get an extra draw to run into them.
And now he knows it's over.
Yeah. Hey, at least nobody will see that guy.
I like that attack initially to ensure that he has full information about what's coming out of the Shredder. And he can't get, sort of screwed over by something like a Doomsayer or whatever.
Not that you could do much about it, I guess.
Yeah.
I guess you don't play more stuff on the back of it.
You just have information, and information is valuable.
Yeah. It's actually, Doomsayer would be good because you get your weapon as soon as you can from Tyrion. So you'd almost be happy to find it, probably. Well, this is looking like an auto kill from Firebat, who picked up the Frostbolt right away for the immediate lethal.
Actually just kills him rather than even needing to sweat the possibility of a Lay on Hands draw.
Boom. Well, Archon takes another game over Celestial. So Firebat gets the check mark, which is putting him you know, he can just go home right now and be happy with the work that he did. Celestial might not be able to put a point on the board after all, if this keeps going this way.
They have started to struggle there. I mean, that's a matchup that they really can't be expecting to win. You know, the mid-range Paladin against Freeze Mage 1 is a tough one to begin with. Yeah. So, and I mean, we have not really seen, other than in the hands of Strifecrow, mid-range Paladin do particularly well in this league in general. So that may be a matchup where Celestial could also continue to struggle here.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know what Frozen Ice is going to do with his two decks. We've seen them already. I hope he draws better with his Zoo. Because if that ends up being the exact same thing, how good would it be versus like a Mech Shaman from 6 Elgara? Like, I know you play a lot of Shaman yourself. Well, then again, you both play a lot of it, but...
That will be like the biggest problem for Archon. And this is like the biggest hope for Celestial to get, just to reverse sweep the Mech Shaman. You can't really expect to get more than one win on the Patron Warrior. It's like their only hope is just to reverse sweep the Mech Shaman. But the problem is that the Shaman has two good matchups with the Freeze Mage of Frozen Eyes and the Patron Warrior of Tiddler. The other two decks he will most likely lose.
You'd probably be somewhat right.
Just give it a few more days, then Paladin will rise to tier 1.
Oh man, I am so scared of Paladin after TGT. I'm going to take like a vacation from Hearthstone until the Paladins are out of the way. Then I'll come back. When you guys figure out how to beat them, I'll come back.
Well, Paladin is right here, so we're going to see if Paladin is going to be able to beat people today. And I think this is actually probably one of its better matchups. The Mech Shaman. You know, you're playing against a deck where you have a lot of good tools for controlling the early board. You have even, you know, things like Aldor to deal with power maced big creatures, and then you have healing as well with stuff like Healbot and True Silver to get yourself out of burn range. So if Paladin is going to pick up a win, this is where it's going to be. For
Doomhammer. Definitely.
All right, let's see it. If the Shaman doesn't get a good start, we know it can be really inconsistent at times, so it all depends on that early hand. And the Paladin wants to find the Shielded Mini-Bots, is my guess. Coghammer's a great card, though, to have, I think.
Yeah, you go second, you want a Mini-Bot. When you go first, you want Zombie Challenge, just win.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we saw a pretty excruciating Zombie Chow Power Shield opener yesterday versus an aggro deck.
One of the vulnerabilities of Paladin, though, is its inability to deal with Mechwarper, as we're seeing right here. Mechwarper, you know, pretty much every class has some way to, you know, kill a Mechwarper on turn two. They can do 3 damage. Paladin just cannot.
Yeah, right, Seal of Light did nothing to help.
I mean,
I don't like this.
Yeah,
I would have liked to coin Aldor, man.
100% coined out an Aldor. You need to get in the board here, I feel like. And you have Coghammer to make your Aldor, you know, even better.
Yes. Yes, against aggro decks, you don't save your hand. You just get stuff out.
Yeah, I definitely can't really get behind this play from Silent Storm. I think that he's getting a little bit greedy with the Aldor and with the coin.
So the play maybe is to try to, you know, pretend you've got a Blessing of Kings on the back end. Set up a Consecration if the opponent attacks with Mechwarper.
But he doesn't have a Consecration.
Yeah, but, you know, your opponent might not attack, and then you can keep the 1-1 for Kings. So it's like, either way, you've got something, maybe.
The main reason is, like, he gets punished by Power Mace, but you get punished if you just Hero Power the same way. Mm-hmm. But if he doesn't have a Power Mace, you're in a super good spot. with the because you have the core camera in your hand, and he had it already. It's not like he has to draw it.
Definitely not where you want to be right now as a paladin. This is two little taunts that are going to be super aggravating to go through. You've used up your corn in the shredder, so never mind that Belcher coming down to defend you. You're going to be taking a lot of phase damage for a little bit. So Aldor is going to have to come out for sure. Oh my god.
What is happening?
There it is. There's no Aldor. Another round of damage coming directly to the face. Now the question becomes...
This is reasonable, I think, actually, because you're able to clear through the Annoyotron and put yourself in a position to take out the Taunt Totem. One of the things about Paladin is that its removal is largely minion weapon-based, not really spell-based, so those resilient taunts are actually kind of a big deal. And getting the ability to get through one of them this turn and set yourself up to kill the other the next turn, I think, is actually quite strong.
Yeah, let's put our faith in Silent Storm. You know, he's one of the better control paladins out there. Maybe he knows this matchup inside and out and saw his hand and figured he doesn't have to rush to deal with everything.
Have four guard destroyers, not seven guard destroyers. I'm kind of jealous.
It's especially good now that BGH is kind of removed from the metagame. Like, nobody plays it much anymore. So, yeah. Seven is optimal, just about in any circumstance, anyway.
I do like to get the best possible version of my cards.
Yeah. You do? Oh, that's game.
That is a big, big draw here. So Consecration, wow.
Wipes the board. Okay. That's it?
Yeah, this actually just kills everything.
Yeah.
I think, right?
Nothing left.
Consecration... Yeah. No, not quite. Not quite.
You use your face and your 1/1s to kill that.
If he does face tank the Yeti, yeah, this is just a game winning consecration right here. He's able to clear the entire board. He's at 18, which is, you know, you are playing.
The irony.
A blessing of kings is real.
The irony.
This is gonna be
Sabomatic has betrayed you. He's betrayed you.
Right.
I actually like plating on the Zap-O-Matic to protect it from at least just a single hit of Doomhammer. Maybe your opponent is just going to Doomhammer your face, though, so maybe it's not worthwhile.
He's very, like, he likes to save his cards.
Oh my goodness. Doomhammer. I would have used that armor plating just because.
I mean, it's, you know, getting that guy suited up when you have both Coghammer and Blessing of Kings in your hand.
Against a non-hex deck,
keeping him alive seems pretty valuable.
Well, he's still in a pretty okay position. The thing is, as his health gets lower and lower, Xyxel starts picking up any type of reach, and that's it, right? Like, you just pick up crackles and bursts, and you're good. You almost don't need anything else.
And I think this is what Silent Storm was planning for. He wanted to suit up the Belcher the next turn, giving it the 6th point of health. That's actually a pretty big deal, in that it gets it out of both. Single Rockbiter into the taunt with the Doomhammer, as well as Lava Burst range, both of which are pretty relevant removal effects in this particular matchup.
Yeah, I think you're right. Like, this Belcher is actually even more an annoyance than it looked like it was going to be, and he's still going to double face tank it to put it into easier kill range, even beyond this. Wow, a lot of damage taken.
That's hilarious.
So, Iron BKL, Aldor, and then you kill that Shredder.
Do I have to kill it?
Yeah, I don't know that you necessarily do. I think you might actually.
You
may just kings it and send it at your opponent's face.
Yeah, you kings it and let him double hit it again. It's you want to double hit my Belcher again.
Right, Xyxo did not Earthshock it last turn.
Which he would have done if he had it.
Very likely would have done, but there is an Earthshock!
And that's game, isn't it?
While he may have done it last turn, he does not really have the... He can do it this turn, but that's not quite lethal, is it? He has 4, 5, 6, 7...
But are you sure it's not lethal with Lava Burst and Crackle? I think it could
Crackle
be,
hits
yeah.
For full. Is this lethal?
I'm pretty sure it is, yeah.
It is now, yes.
Even with a low roll, it's still fine.
Oh, dear.
Even with low roll, you still had it. You had to get like a 75% win rate on the Crackle alone.
Low roll, he would not. He had a 50% shot there, which is why he went the Crackle first.
Well, no, 4 was fine. You were okay with 75.
It could hit 3, right? Isn't it 3?
Well, he could have hit.
6? Yeah. So, regardless,
Yeah, whatever.
The crackle closes things out. Right. I mean, there, I do think that Silent Storm was playing sort of with the information, okay, you know, he didn't Earthshock my guy last turn, which he would have done, and I'm safe to do this, but the top deck Earthshock from Zixo was enough to close it out.
But you should expect that for the first taunt, at least. I think he played too greedy early game. Like, he had double Aldor, he died with an Aldor in his hand. It's not like he needed them later. And every point of health matters so much against that Korean Mech Shaman version. So, I think he played too greedy early game, and that's why he lost.
I mean, he died like with a barely... hammer in his hand, too. You know, he died with a bunch of these really valuable defensive cards in his hand because he sort of tried to preserve them over the course of the early game into the mid game. And I really think that that game, a lot of it was defined by that turn, too, where he chose not to coin and he chose to play just his hero power. I mean, he did get, you know, use of the coin later, but I think that he just gave up so much early tempo that that really punished him.
And I also know that, like, his version doesn't run heal besides of one lay on hands. So even if he would stabilize with his playstyle, eventually, like, Xixo could just burst him down with direct damage spells if he doesn't draw the one lay on hands.
Yeah, I didn't even realize he didn't have something like Healbot. You know, not having Healbot in your deck definitely makes it even more important that you're fighting for that early tempo.
Yeah, it's actually a really, I think this is one of the few matchups you really can't afford to be greedy with. It's kind of like facing off against Facehunter. If you can deflect most of the early aggression, you might be fine. So just go all in on deflecting that and don't try to play like a slowish game because you're just going to get burnt out. And I think Shaman, it's even truer of Shaman because of the fact that Crackle and Lava Burst reach for so much. And they have four copies of that high burst spell in their deck, so... You can't really afford to be greedy at any point.
It really depends so much on the list that people play. Like, if Xixo would have played the Felreaver version, it makes sense to keep the Aldor Peacekeepers for that. But he had, like, the early game, a lot of burst damage. And also, like, the Paladin version, he runs, doesn't play double lay on hands or heal bots. So he really needs to prevent damage early game. So it was, like, in both ways, the wrong playstyle with his Paladin list and against Xixo's Shaman list.
And this is a really unfortunate position for Team Celestial, where they think that their best chance to beat the one remaining deck on the opposing team is the mirror match. they feel like they have no better matchups than a 50-50 here.
And everyone agrees on that.
Right. They are right. Like, they have Midrange Paladin, Freeze Mage, and Zoo left to try and pick up a win against Patron Warrior. So,
oh my,
this is. Looking like it is not going to be the sort of final glorious comeback for Team Celestial. It appears we may have another 6-2 on our hands if this goes Zalay's way.
Yeah, the match point is on the line here for Team Archon, which, I mean, they've got to be pretty happy about winning this one because I think there was a way for them to end up much lower on the ladder, and it involved losing to Team Celestial. So that's got to make them feel a lot more comfortable.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Archon winning here, you know, they can't end up somehow falling to the redemption match tomorrow. They're going to be, pretty much guaranteed. I mean, the match is still going on, but I will say that it is very unlikely that they fail to make stage two.
Yeah, I think they're securing third place by winning this, like, guaranteed. And if they lose and they only had, I think, like, four wins on the loss...
Sure?
They might have gone down to.
Are you sure? I feel
that,
like,
they're guaranteed to, like.
It's like a three-way tie, I think, for third place, because, like, Nihilum beat Archon, we beat Nihilum, and Archon beat us.
Well, I don't think that the heads up actually has anything to do with the placing. I think that the game differential was what was determined, because if it was just heads up, we would be in first place, not Cloud9, because we beat them.
Yeah.
Right.
But we had a really good game differential.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the game differential is the first step, and then if then there's a tie, then you start looking at the head-to-head, which in this case doesn't really end up mattering because there's no tie on the tiebreaker.
It's not over yet.
Yeah.
That's true.
They're still playing.
Right. Like, the game is still ongoing. Maybe just Celestial stomps Team Archon. Maybe it happens. In the meantime, though, one player has Emperor and the other doesn't.
Well, I mean, both players do have very strong hands here. You know, both players have a lot of tools. The Emperor is obviously a pretty big deal on Tiddler's side, but
Patrons, man. These patrons.
Patrons just, you know, start coming right now. We got patron interage attack you.
Yeah, it was a snap play from Tiddler as well. I think it's been widely recognized now that just if you can get that patron warrior, having to deal with minions that multiply when you deal one damage to them, they have no removal for this. They need like double execute slams, and exact cards. Because anytime they try to go for one AoE, they punish themselves.
Yeah, I mean the Emperor is a powerful card when the games go long and you're looking to set up those big combo finishes. But just turn 5 for patrons is able to end the game pretty quickly.
No. It's always that fourth patron that makes you want to gouge your eyes out too. Like the three first ones, usually you can deal with. Like if it only had three here, you can manage it. But the moment that there's a fourth one, that's hell. That's just.
It's mostly just the amount of times the sound effect echoes inside of my skull.
Can only take it so much. Kicks in.
Exactly.
And like the playstyle changes completely from getting your own patrons out to killing him with Warsong frothing double wheel wind.
And right now, Zelay has neither of those. He does not have Warsong. He does not have frothing, and he has a whirlwind, which is, you know, powerful. But I mean, right now he's just trying to sort of clear the board a little bit. But this is just gonna.
GG.
I was going to say, this is just going to generate an additional patron for
it's,
Tiddler.
It's over.
It's generate a lot more than that.
That's it, I think. I mean, how the hell are you supposed to deal with this? Like, he could deal with 3, not 4. It's always that same problem that arises, and the combo is perfectly set up to where you're always going to have 4 as warrior. What's really interesting, too, is that initially Blizzard, I think, wanted to make the patrons 4-2s instead of 3-3s. But they thought the card would be too bad to play. And I think they're right, for the most part. The reason it works so well is because it has so much health and an exact amount of attack that works with Warsong. But it makes it so good in matchups like this one. It's so unreal.
I mean, I think that the third health is a huge deal. Because it
really is, yeah.
Not only does it allow the patrons to actually generate multiple additional patrons from a single card, but also it makes them out of range of most of the most commonly played AoE effects like Consecration and Holy Nova.
And Power Shot soon
Blizzard
enough.
As well. But yeah,
actually. Oh, no, there's no Warsong.
No, it's still no Warsong, but.
Could he live until he can pull it off? I think there might be a way for him to live. He'd have to play Acolyte of Pain here and try to get.
That's nothing.
Yeah, there's really nothing.
See, he doesn't have enough mana to actually play Warsong plus patron. He's going.
Another patron.
No, that's what I meant. I meant Warsong plus frothing. But like, he has to draw into it and then find it.
This is excruciating. You have the cards. You just can't do anything with them.
It's like one of the most anticlimactic mirror matches ever. Like whoever gets the patrons out first, and if the opponent doesn't have the frothing, it's like. Pretty much.
Well, it kind of feels like Druid very often, right? Where one player gets a curve, the other doesn't, and you're kind of just sitting there waiting for somebody to get the Force of Nature Savage Aura out. Sometimes I feel that way about Druid as well.
Reload.
So here, the only way you really lose the game is if your opponent gets a crazy frothing. So you have to be cautious, at the very least, and armor up as much as you can.
Yeah, I mean, he can just shield block, hero power, and he's even, you know, cycling through his deck with that Battle Rage to set up, even if, you know, somehow something goes wrong that doesn't immediately kill him, which there really isn't anything that can do that, I don't think.
Yeah.
But,
yeah, right.
he's just getting in there is what he's doing.
And you're also not so scared of the frothing if you didn't play the Emperor. It's like very expensive, like the Super Burst combo.
And that's nice. That's not gonna do it.
All right, so Team Celestial, yeah, they're on the comeback trail, picking up win number 3. But from here on out, it's rough. They are still going to be playing against Zelay's Patient Warrior deck every game. And like we said at the beginning of that, they felt like their best chance was sending in the mirror match. Now they have 3 decks that tend to struggle against Patron.
Yeah. Well, we'll see exactly if... I mean, Patron has no absolutely terrible matchups either way. So if you're up against a Patron, you have to win so many matches in a row. No matter what your lineup is, I think you've got to feel a little uneasy about it. But it might be made worse by the fact that those matchups are not even that great in the first place.
Mm-hmm. I'm actually curious, what do you think that the best remaining matchup for Celestial is?
Zoo, definitely. It's not even close.
Yeah, that's what I would have gone with as well. I know that there's some people who think that Freeze Mage is reasonable against it, but I think they're crazy.
Yeah. And Saleh plays it perfect, that matchup. Like we've seen, he knows he has a game plan from turn one. He knows exactly how to play this.
Yeah, he's playing to fatigue from turn one, basically, which is kind of crazy to me. But
it's obvious. You can see it when he plays. Like starting turn one, he's already on that line of play, and you know that the game's gonna last forever. But eventually, he's gonna grind his opponent out of it.
Mm-hmm. Also, statistically, the infamous monk statistics. Zoo is favorite against Patron. Also, by 55% or something. Mm-hmm. So it is actually a favorable matchup, so you go for the Zoo.
Yeah. All right.
Those wins in for the tiebreakers. Yeah. get out of that eighth spot. Oh, wait. It's absolutely not happening.
Too soon.
I'm getting this, I'm casting a bit with Crip recently, and I'm getting this whole vibe from him that he kind of, it's contagious, I think, where you like to see people be miserable. It's not something I used to be like, but I'm getting to that point the more and more I cast.
He's also very fatalistic a lot of times, and he's just like, you know, he would have gone into that, the Freeze Mage versus Paladin match we actually saw before, where Freeze Mage actually ended up winning with Strife Code. Be like, well, Strife was already lost, turn one, game's over.
It's good. Yeah, 99% chance
the Freeze Mage wins.
Yeah.
Honestly, I think that the chance that they should get the prize if Celestial wins, because right now I think they have a chance of 1% to win. Yeah.
So the most consecutive wins against the Patron deck ever in the history of Hearthstone, and they get that trophy, right?
Because the two worst decks against Patron are double Zombie Chow, Control Warrior, Control Paladin with just one equality, what he plays, and Freeze Mage.
Let's see it. I want to see the comeback, the crazy Celestial trophy, just crushing Archon after four wins in a row against Patron. So see, it can go either way. Like I like seeing Team Celestial having their souls crushed on one end, but I'd also enjoy the reverse. You know, if it happened.
If he would be playing poker, he would probably win.
He has two pair. It's a pretty good hand.
Yeah. Let's flip over the hands and see who wins. Yeah. Yeah, the other one has a three card straight. It's not too bad. And a pair.
Oh, out there in the chat, who are you guys rooting for? Are you rooting for the epic Celestial comeback or Team Archon? Let us know on Twitter, hashtag ATLC and
smooth.
Maybe. Ooh. Oh, and we got a slam going in, taking out that Night Juggler. Reducing the early offense, and this is kind of a mediocre draw, I would say, from Frozen Ice here. He has Juggler, but those eggs are not particularly great without to enable them.
What a surprise. Mediocre draw by Frozen Ice. He looks so sad. He's like, really? What have I done wrong in my life to deserve this? He's drawn so bad.
If he plays the other Juggler, right, he's like bound to lose it to the Ghoul, so... Not even.
But just an egg. Does yeah.
You mean it's not great pressure? It's amazing. Oh god, I'm dying here. So poor Frozen Ice.
It's alright.
I think the egg's fine, right? You'd play it, right? In most cases, would you play that over Juggler, or are you gonna hope that there's no second slam, Fiery War Axe, etc.?
I mean, the way how Zoo wins against Patron is with early game pressure, and that doesn't really look like early game pressure.
Oh, hello. Good thing he didn't play that Juggler. His soul would have been crushed even further.
I mean, the openings that actually, when I was playing with Zoo, that I tended to like the most against Patron were actually just Egg into Void Terror. But I don't know how many Void Terrors that Frozen Ice actually is playing, and certainly he's not drawing them.
Yeah, we haven't seen it in the first game he played it.
Yeah, I don't think that it seems like he has at least many of them. Looks like he may be just thinking of Power Overwhelming to clear this Acolyte off the board and give himself a 4-4.
Yeah, he gets one Knife Juggle hit for all that matters. I mean, or in this case, at least a 4-4 is going to be somewhat useful, but... That's kind of upside. If there's no Death Spite, at least you're gonna get some value out of the 4/4, or some damage rather, more so than value.
His hand is so bad, he has to do it.
Yeah. Trey's Acolyte Pain.
And Death Bite? Yes, no, nope, not quite.
Death Bite just yet. So, you know, this is a situation where the 4/4 is going to be able to stick around at least for a little bit.
Yeah. Do you just play the Fire War Axe, kill the Juggler, and play the Ghoul, or do you just play it a bit slower, where you just play the Ghoul and see what happens, and then maybe work with your Execute and Axe after that point?
To be honest, I have played very little Patient Warrior, so I'm sure my answer is wrong. But I think that I would probably here, use the Fire War Axe, take out the Juggler, and then probably just armor up. But it looks like he's going to go with the Ghoul. Like, I would imagine wanting to hold the Ghoul to be able to play perhaps like Ghoul Acolyte of Pain in the following turn to be able to dig a little bit more. But I can definitely recognize wanting to do it as much as you can to sort of prevent the incoming damage here.
Yeah, it's also setting up the really good execute. Like, you're pretty happy about that, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man. His hand is so clunky.
It really is.
I think it's pretty clunky for both players. And Zoo has pretty good potential to improve on this, depending on... The problem is winning the game, because you might have a good board and a good hand as Zoo player, even going further. But the problem is still sealing the game by attacking the opponent's face, which right now the warrior is not even remotely threatened. Like, he's not nearly at the 20 health mark that you'd like to see him at by turn 4. It's looking a little difficult.
Looks like he might want to play the Imp Gang boss to get an extra imp when he attacks into this ghoul. This is a little bit awkward because it does give him a 1/1, but it makes both of his minions on board vulnerable to both execute and that War Axe is already in play.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, he damages his Imp Gang boss to get a 1/1.
Yeah. It's trading one health for 1/1, I guess.
Against Patron Warrior.
Yeah, it's... Well, I mean, he's not quite on the Patron turn just yet.
Yeah.
Right? Like, he's still very far away from getting a charged Patron.
Yeah, I mean, just, like, Gang Boss with 4 toughness is so much more difficult to kill.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're forcing a Death Bite out of your opponent. So this is going to be a full clear plus a card draw for Zolay.
It's looking pretty good. This wouldn't have really been a possibility if he hadn't, you know, put that damage on his Imp Gang boss. If he just, you know, attacked, played the Imp Gang boss post combat.
Right. You've got to feel at some point as well that maybe the morale is not there anymore. You know, after going that deep in a league and then you're at your last game potentially of the last day. For sportsmanship, you're here, but maybe they're not trying as hard as they might have otherwise.
Yeah, that, I wanted to bring that up earlier. Like, it must be so... Like, they play for multiple hours. Like, even, like, last week, they couldn't really, like, get into the redemption, even.
No, they couldn't. They had a good chance to do it. Like, the setup was there. They had a chance of doing it.
So after that, you really must feel demotivated to give your best.
Yeah. But it's always like this in a league. There's always one team who falls so far behind so early. And they never quite recover from it. Like, there's always one team that gets crushed, and it had to be someone. Celestial's taking that hit for the entirety of the rest of the teams, I guess.
And we appreciate that.
Your sacrifice will be remembered, Celestial.
I mean, here, you know, Frozen doesn't really have many good plays. Like, you can... Yeah, it looks like he's just going to go face, which it definitely...
It's not quite over, though, is it?
No, it's not, but it's not looking good.
Mm. Zolay would have to whiff a lot, to actually, because the thing is, his hand can only improve from here on out, I think. And he's got the card draw that he wants to make that improvement happen.
He can actually Warsong into Frothing, attack the Acolyte into the 4/1, and then attack the Frothing into the Imp.
Would you kill the Imp? Oh my goodness. Okay, so now you can even kill the 1/1 that comes out of it if you want. You're so weak to Abusive Sergeant with a 6/2 anyway, and you might need that Inner Rage for something else. Yeah, okay, so he holds on to it. I think it makes sense.
Yeah, I like that. Oh. And now this defender is actually quite good.
Yeah, it's really good.
Wow, it's really good.
But then again,
well, this egg not popping away is such a problem. Oh, yeah. But I think
I would live tap for sure.
Yeah. I try it out.
Yeah, I think what you do here is power bombing attack trade into the
prodding.
Yeah, that's good enough.
And I hope he never has a patron ever in his life.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, we want to make sure that the board is completely gone.
Now, there is not yet a patron, so
it's a big deal.
Yeah, absolutely. There is the second commander waiting though, and I think. Do you think we're gonna see War Axe to clear the two power guy, or do you just want to leave that in play and hope to find a patron?
You could wipe the board with just the Inner Rage execute. So I guess.
Nah, like at this point, you have to expect Dr. Boom Marganis, Doom Guards. How do you kill that? It's like even a bigger threat. Like this last card in his hand could easily be.
Oh Doom God! Could this be it? Is Frozen Ice coming back?
Wow. This seems.
I really didn't expect that. Yeah, I really didn't expect that execute.
Yeah, I mean now you're just here comes Dr. Boom.
And now the Doom Guard top decks are just so sick from here on out. There's really nothing to stop them.
I mean, the
and
draws
are gonna deal full damage.
The draws looked so bad and so anticlimactic.
Yeah. Well,
this patron.
Execute.
It's patron.
That's a pretty good outcome. So the boom boss will matter a lot here. Like, what if it kills a Warsong commander right away?
Or the patron.
The new patron. So you get like a 40% chance of hitting one of the good targets, and then within that, a 50% to kill something you'd like. Like a 10% chance this game could still be Frozen Ices.
But what else to do? Go for the Deathbite first. But like wait one turn, you know?
To get more patrons? I could see that. But it's kind of slow against the 7-7. Not that you can handle it anyway. What happens?
It's so funny when you really hope for RNG. I mean, he needs the RNG.
Nope, doesn't get it.
Both players need the good RNG.
And now he's gonna just kill Dr. Boom straight up. Oh! Oh! Wow!
Oh, God.
Oh, this is hell.
That was exactly the worst possible result. You see Frozen Ice. Oh, dear.
it's RNG is absolutely atrocious.
Yeah, that was a huge, huge swing with the.
That's useless.
No, that's great, man. You can give him more patrons. You can get everybody in here.
Yeah, but it's over. It's like. It comes to this point.
Zilly grinning there after that boom bot. Yeah, saving him 7 life, basically putting him totally out of reach of any kind of Doomguard comeback.
So Doomguard could still. Oh, never mind. No, this is a complete.
You have 2 cards that have drop. You have three cards that have drawbacks in your hand right now. You just can't play them.
It's just over. it's just.
What,
over.
What if he plays like Hellfire in that Zoo deck?
He doesn't.
Then he could clear the board.
Yeah, it's been seen, but not of recent memory, unfortunately.
If Noxious would be playing instead of Frozen Ice, he definitely would have a Hellfire. Yeah.
Of course, yeah. I'd lose against everything but this situation. That's pretty much what would happen in my Hellfire. I'm gonna face like Hunters.
Oh, look.
This is so classic. It's just over. He got 2 patrons, it's over.
Yeah. And that is the game.
Oh, more.
Oh, look.
Yo, I heard you like patrons.
Put
a patron in your patron, so you can patron while you patron.
Everyone has gotten in here. There's really not much room left for anyone else, because everyone's here.
Well, there's still a few people missing. I mean, I think those dwarves need to get their counting skills up, because obviously not everyone's here. Every single time somebody else comes along.
Enough people are at the party. So funny.
So the imp to patron ratio needs to at least be equal in order to end this game on a good.
I really wanted to see that be 2 just for the total rub-in. Because that really would just be a classic end to Frozen Ice's time here in ATLC.
Then he should have done it on the Patreon.
Yeah. And then maybe multiply it on top of spawning two imps. Well, that is going to be match point for Team Archon, which is, you know, that's excruciating for Team Celestial because they couldn't even get that point on the table that everybody was rooting for. I think pretty much everyone was, you know, despite the jabs that we've made at their score. We were really hoping they could upset one team's chances at maybe securing a good spot in the league, but didn't happen. Where does that put Team Archon in the standings? That puts them third place, and they're pretty much secure there because Temple Storm's already played. I don't think Force and Boys could possibly catch up. Even if they win 6-0 against Team Liquid, they still couldn't beat Team Archon due to the game wins count. So no matter what happens, Team Archon is going to be securing third place in this exact spot. There could be some shuffling around between fourth and seventh, and those the match here between Team Liquid and Force and Boys matters more for Force and Boys, I believe, because they have a chance of getting out of Redemption and pushing Nihilim down. Nihilim could, in the very worst case scenario, I think go below Force and Boys.
Yeah, I believe right now it looks like Force and Boys, they have, it looks like, a differential of 2, 30 game wins, to 28 losses, while Nihilim have 34, 36. So if Force and Boys wins with a differential of greater than 2, I believe, mm-hmm. or even greater than 1, I think that they actually will leapfrog Nihilim for that placing.
That is insane, because like 2 weeks ago, Nihilim was
If Nihilim had won last week, they were locked for live finals already, and they lost last week and then lost again this week, and maybe
They had to lose with less than 4 wins mm-hmm. in order to get knocked out, and they got three wins when they lost, which was exactly the cut that they couldn't possibly have to make, and then they lost again, a crazy sweep too. So that's putting them in a really unfortunate spot. I know RD had a really rough day, and the last few weeks have been rough for him. So I hope he's still not going to be too affected by this going forward. So Ryan Kibler, thanks for casting with us. We're going to be moving on to the second match after this. Those were nice games, regardless of the outcome. I enjoyed them.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to see you know, who else will be joining us in Texas. I'm excited. So thanks for having me.
Yeah, pleasure. So before we go, guys, a quick shout out to our partners, alphadraft.com. You can check them out. Esports Fantasy League. You can move there for a you know, a chance of getting a part of the $300,000 that they give away each week. And you can get a matchup on your deposit for $250. So check them out. And Amazon, of course, with the promotion they're running on the App Store, you could get a 50% cut on 40 card packs, classic card pack, to visit teamarcon.com/Hearthstone or Amazon.com. Amazon.com/Hearthstone to check that out. Gara, you'll stay with me. We're going to be back for the second match of the day. This should be kind of exciting. Team Liquid versus Force and Boys. We'll see just how well those last standing shuffles will go. We'll be right back after the break.